mic's on.
Too many or salutes. We're gonna get out of here by 10 o'clock, maybe 5 after 10. So don't worry about a thing. So the bar is open, and just, you know, sit back, relax, and rock it as much as you want. See, there was something else I had to come up with. I've been drinking too much now. I can't think of what it was. The reason I'm here. That's what it was. The reason I'm here is we just had a huge number of guests that we wanted to have as our speaker tonight. And Elon Musk sends his condolences. He was a little busy. They're on a delay. And he couldn't make it. And then we asked Homer Hickam to come. And we offered him this much, and he's got this new book about, anybody know what his new book's about? Dolphins or
alligators?
That's what it was. I couldn't think about it.
He was in Australia
anyway,
with us.
Right now he doesn't care about rocketry. He cares more about alligators, so we don't have him.
Give me a strawberry.
And then we wanted Jay Acton to come in, and Jay, simply nice guy, just already was busy. Okay, so he couldn't come in.
I just want to start.
And then, of course, we wanted the Estes's to come. Not Vern, really, but we wanted Kalita. Because Vern, quite frankly, he talks too much. And so we invited Kalita to come in and tell us the whole truth and the whole story. And Kalita, and now tomorrow we're going to have a card going around. We forgot to get it done tonight. We'll have a card going around. Kalita has been having a problem since she's been stumbling and falling a little bit. She's been hurting her back. And so Vern is trying to do a little better job holding her up on the roller skates. But he's getting up there in age too, and she's just taking a few tumbles, and they just couldn't make it this weekend. So our prayers go up to them. And we'll have a card that we'll pass around tomorrow. Good greetings to Glita. And maybe we'll give her a picture of the cover of our brochure or something like that as something to kind of, you know, cheer her up a little bit about, you know, everything's going fine here in Narcan. So anyway, I was the backup to the backup to the backup. And if it wasn't for Mike here, stand up, Mike, my Jedi Master. See, I'm the dark side, and the dark side and the Jedis had to get together since we're in Ohio. And yeah, you forgot your lightsaber. It's a good thing. You don't need it. You don't need it. These are not the droids. Oh, sorry. That was the other way around, wasn't it? Anyway, it's sit down, Mike. Sit down. Okay. It's Mike's fault that I'm up here. And believe me, I'm good paybacks. So Mike talked me into doing Narcan because he thought it would be such a good idea to have Narcan here in Dayton. And I think that's kind of a neat idea. What do you guys think? Anyway, it's now time to have a conversation, and the conversation is more rocketry.
Drink.
Anyone. Oh yeah, make sure you're drinking, okay? More rocketry from anyone. I think it's something that's pretty important. Model rocketry exists for just a few major reasons, like committed individuals. If you think about it, our hobby could easily have died many years ago, right? Or may never have been born. It's committed individuals that happen to help that along. You know, individuals said, hey, we can do this. We can make this happen. Also, committed organizations, because I don't know about you folks, but I'm very pro-section. And I really think that flying rockets as a group is a whole lot more fun than just going out by yourself and flying rockets. Yeah. Right? All right. Also, a committed industry. I mean, there's people out here that are doing great things in rocketry today to make them available for you folks to fly rocketry. So that's pretty important. And then the most important thing is good science. If it wasn't for good science, there'd be nothing for us. So that's pretty important that we're paying attention to those kind of things. So more rocketry, anyone, is more on the lines now of how do you pay forward? Many pay forward all the time. In fact, you folks in this room are some of the biggest paying forward people in rocketry out there. And that's really critical to our entire hobby. The guy who keeps a small kit available to give to a kid when they need a rocket or need to be introduced to rocketry, that's a pretty cool thing.
Those are available at A-Rockets for a very small sum, aren't they?
Yeah, available. Did you guys hear that? Yeah. Available at E-Rockets for a very small fund. Amount of funds. Anyway, this is Duck Dodgers. Anybody like the character here? Is he a He's a pretty good guy. Okay. I had decided early on that this was going to go to the youngest person in the room, and not a dang kid showed up. Is anybody in the room under 18 years of age?
Rick.
You're under 18 years of age. No.
Amanda.
Goes to Amanda.
No, she's over.
She's
22.
But she's still the youngest one here.
Randy?
Yeah. Is her one
the youngest? All these couples.
Thank you.
She deserves two. Thanks for that.
Awesome. Makes a big difference.
All right, just so you know, we have three people that have traveled from India to be here for NARCON. So, that's right. Now, being helpful on the field, you know, you can do this thing too, give a rocket away. You can go out and find rockets for $3, $4, $5 anytime that opportunity comes up. Throw them in your range box are a great way to get a kid excited about it. And you know how many young kids we have that are out on the field that get excited about this kind of thing. So, you know, use that opportunity. Being helpful on the field is another thing. You know, so many of the newer rocketeers are so intimidated by us and our expertise and the science. They're really, truly intimidated. Think about it. Think about you going to a remote RC airplane convention or something like that, how out of place you would be. A lot of these people that come and fly with us have that exact scenario going on. They're out of place. They're interested, but they don't have a clue as to what's going on and how things work. A perfect example to that was the WSR group went to an event called TechFest here a few weeks ago. Never in my life had I seen a scenario where we saw maybe a few thousand people come to our booth, and we gave 500 business cards away that talked about our club and E-Rockets, and just reminding you guys, okay, that we exist and that we have regular functions that go on in the community here. And guys, help me out. We have like 5 visitors within 2 weeks to club meetings and stuff. So 500 cards, 5 visitors. Never seen anything like that before. So that was pretty cool. But the little things matter when you're out on the field. That person that doesn't have an igniter or that might be doing something wrong, helping them out, providing recovery wadding or advice in any way, shape, or form, or just a friendly smile or a high five that, hey, that's a really cool rocket, whether it is or not. it's a really cool rocket, and it's great to see it fly. A lot of you already, when you do first flights, you're always giving them high fives and praise for doing those fantastic flights. So those are the kind of things that really matter to these new people that are involved in rocketry. So be paying forward all the time. It can be in little increments all the time. You don't have to do something big in order to get the attention that is needed to advance the hobby. It's you guys, little by little, that does it. Kids remember things. In 15 years from now, they're going to say, hey, my kids and I are interested in a hobby. And maybe that will turn into rocketry. I know that turned into rocketry for me because when I was reborn, it was pretty interesting because my wife, my wife Carol, by the way, right over there. So sorry, honey. She told me, she was mad at me one day because I'm hanging around and we got this newborn in the house. Her name was Amanda. Amanda was just a newborn. She's about 1 year old. And Carol was scolding me one day saying, gosh, stop hanging around me and all the time you're bothering me.
Yeah.
Get a hobby. And I said, well, what am I going to do? She says, well, what'd you do as a kid? I says, well, I have a box of rockets in the attic and I have a box of trains in the attic. And she says, which one? Do one of them. I says, okay, fine. I'm
going to
get the rockets out. And of course, the funny story is 5 years later, after Amanda's old enough to realize what's going on, we've already been doing rocketry. I tell the story to somebody. She says, we have rockets. I had my choice, rockets or trains. And the first thing out of her mouth is, we have trains? So anyway, we moved on, and we got involved in rocketry, and shortly after the We Have Trains thing, Amanda started flying competitions. So she's like 5 years old going to these competitions with me and starting to realize, hey, this is pretty cool. I go to these competitions in the Detroit area, and I can play with all the kids on the playground. It's a lot of fun going to rockets. She never flew a rocket right away, but after a few years, she got to the point where Dad, you guys are funny, you know, the way you stick a rocket on the pad, you fly it, some goofball's timing it or whatever, and you win medals. That's pretty cool. I think I want to try it. And so at 7 years old, Amanda started building her first rockets and flying them. And so that's just one of the cool things. Now, she kind of kept me into the hobby. It's a good thing she did because, you know, it gets boring and I could have gotten out of it any time, right? After all, I had those trains to go play with. I could have stopped any time. This is like a drug addiction, you know that, right? But heaven forbid some kid could get interested in rocketry because of you. So remember that those are real opportunities for you. And you know what? It's like, this is interesting because Amanda's been in rocketry for a long time. She's going to college. She's doing great. And you know what her major is? You would think that she would get into engineering or rocket science or something like that, but no. She's majoring in drinking and boys in college, and she's pretty close to graduating.
Hit him, Amanda.
Amanda, what are you going to get into?
Diagnostic medical sonography.
Yeah, that lot. And stuff too, so we got to say thank you to the NAR for helping your dad out a lot. All right, but heaven forbid we provide interest to some kids and somebody might get into aerospace engineering, right, Joe?
Huh?
No,
right, Joe?
Joe.
Aerospace engineering, Joe? Brian? Brian? No, not Brian. Joe? Wait a minute, good school, Purdue. Where do you go?
Okay,
Purdue, Case. I mean, that's like going to Ohio State. I mean, I can't help it. I'm proud of Brian, too. He's done a great job. And we've had a number of people go through programs that interest has had, rocketry has interested in them. Brian, did you ever think rocketry was going to lead you to aerospace engineering? Or is that where it all came from? You were interested in aerospace engineering, and you found rockets. Okay. Now, Joe, I know he's just chasing girls, but...
Oh, yeah, totally.
Yeah, see? And Purdue, a drinking college again. You know, what can we say? So, Joe, was it rocketry first or engineering first?
I was raised on science fiction. That's a very good question.
Science fiction?
I think it was more just space.
Okay.
What do? I get a job, and now I learn how to make spaceships even better.
That's right. So, yeah, so that's good. So these kids are influenced, and for the few the many that are not here, they may be home right now, and in a few years they're going to have kids of their own, or they're going to have their wives tell them, get off your butt and go do a hobby or do something. And that's a great opportunity for them. And it's only because they were introduced by you folks to get them there. So take advantage of influencing and getting into these people's lives so that they have an opportunity just like you've had. As an individual, you can also get to the point where doing rocketry is a whole lot more fun when you're in a group, right? Everybody agrees to that already. Sport launches, whether they're small or large, they all matter. You know, if you've got a small field that can only fly D or E motors, that's okay. That's okay, there's nothing wrong with that. That is a great opportunity to start a flying opportunity and start a flying family and get people involved. High power fields are really good too. You know, low power fields, you can start to get them introduced into competition and those kind of things. High power fields, you can get them, it's easier to get them more involved in getting certifications so they can get bigger and bigger rockets and fly bigger and bigger rockets. So get a small group flying. If you're not in a small group flying, do it. It's the most fun you can possibly have. And it's a great way to promote the hobby too, because now you can draw people in that are interested in this kind of thing. Get a small group of people building rockets. I don't think we do this enough. And I know the Whovirus group in the Detroit area, they're really, really good about having regular build sessions, 10 or 11 times a year, right, Steve?
Okay,
all right. But they think of it. See, I've been to some of their section meetings, and it's really good because it's like a big party, right? I mean, I remember one time we were there blow molding just for the heck of it, and it's like, who's done blow molding in the last month or two? You know, it's one of those things where you can learn new skills all the time. But building rockets, getting together as a group is great. Great opportunity if you build rockets together. Start a club. Be in our section. It's really easy to be in our section today. You know how many people we require to start in our section? People are holding their hands up like this. It is two. It only takes two people. And those two people can start a section, and the NAR will help support them. We'll give you a NAR banner. We'll get you safety vests for flying. We'll make monies available through a grant program to help you get equipment, get marketing material. So all these things are possible through the grant program with the NAR. So the NAR can be very, very, very valuable to sections that are brand new starting up. And it doesn't hurt the old sections either. If you have a need that's safety related or equipment related or marketing related, ask for the money. The worst case scenarios, we'd say no, right? And here the president is just saying it just never happens. And that's absolutely true. I don't know of a single time he's rejected or they've rejected a grant request. So if you need it, it's justifiable, do it. You know, especially the marketing end of it, the equipment end of it, and the safety end of it. Many people pay forward. Many individuals pay forward. And I really am encouraging you guys to pay forward in a small way all the time. But once in a while, we get a scenario where someone comes up with some harebrained idea that turns out to be something in a big way. And those are really important, too. So Trip Barber, you know, he's one of those guys that came up with this harebrained idea to get a whole bunch of high schools across the country to compete in this thing called Team America Rocketry Challenge. Now, you can applaud. He's a good guy. He did a nice job with that. Thank you, Trip. Thank you very much. And what it means, it means something big to us. And sometimes we don't totally realize it. Hey, it's grand that we've got this big national thing, and it's extremely well organized and well attended and very highly looked on and has great prizes to go with it too on the national end, and that's fine and dandy. It also gives us as individuals an opportunity to pay forward and volunteer. Now, how many people here have volunteered to help at TARP? Come on. How many people have been to TARP? Wow, that's impressive. Thank you folks for doing that. But it goes beyond that. Don't forget that every one of you in this room probably should have raised your hand, because how many people here have helped a TARP team in some way, shape, or form? Okay? Almost every hand in the room went up. Good, because that's exactly what TARC is for. It's not the national thing that's the big deal. It's the fact that the kids are getting introduced to a great program and have an opportunity to ask you to be their mentor. And there's nothing better than that. That mentorship is extremely valuable to them. And believe it or not, it's valuable to you too. Because it tells you that, hey, I'm putting another big foot forward in paying for making my hobby greater and better. It means more rocketry for all of us. Okay? Yeah, rocketry. So that's a very good thing. Joining the NAR is another area where it's pretty important. And almost everyone here is a NAR member. And we really encourage for this NARCon that you be a NAR member coming in, because you guys got a discount this year for being a NAR member. And it was worth every penny to make that available to you. I would rather see us benefit from our membership of being NAR members. I want to encourage people to become NAR members to even come to something like this. It's very good and very joyful to see that going on. And when you become a NAR member, one of the first things you start to do is start to look at sections. Because it's a lot more fun flying rockets as a group, right? And that's exactly what a section does. Most of the long-term rocketeers that have been in the hobby for the longest, they belong in sections. These guys that go out and fly by themselves or maybe with their family, they do it for a few years, they drop out. They become born again. They find a section, they stay in it for a longer period of time. So that's pretty important, because we're filling a major role to a lot of folks here by having a section available to fly rockets, have the camaraderie, build rockets, and do rocketry-related things. So if you're not in a section, who is not? Maybe I should ask that question. Who is in a section? Let's raise hands for the positive things. Who is in a section today? Almost everybody in the room. That's wonderful. So a section is an important community for us in the rocketry area. Your section has an opportunity. It's actually an asset to the community itself. Teaching safety, teaching that it's an educational hobby, and just that whole field of opportunity that's available for being in rocketry. It might be a small program that your section has. You might have a small field. That's okay. In fact, I think that we're hurting in sections across the country because we don't have enough small fields. We need more small fields so that people can get introduced to the hobby and not be so intimidated by the really big stuff. Of course, those sections that have big fields, take advantage of that. You know, we only have those for so long. Who knows how long it'll be before most large fields are not available. So take advantage of that as well. But be thinking about the small field. There's no reason the section can't have a small field. Now, Right Stuff Rocketry is the local section that's kind of hosting us this weekend. And they have a small field and a large field. So the large field is only available in the wintertime. Whoops, Larry Rice is calling me. I think we'll hang up on Larry. Sorry, Larry. Probably needs directions.
Be a little late, Mike.
All right, how do I follow this?
Rocket!
Salute! There we go, that got us out of it. Hey, Larry, are you there? Larry! Hey! Hi, Larry, it's Randy. Can you guys all hear him? Okay. Hi, Larry. What's going on?
Well, we're coming in the morning. I need some information.
Hi, Larry. Larry, did you hear everybody?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay, Larry, we're making a lot of fun of you. Can you call me back first thing in the morning?
Yeah.
Okay. Larry's a very decisive guy. Okay, that'd be great. I'll talk to you in the morning. Bye-bye. You guys put people on the spot. You know, this is the second phone call I've taken on stage because somebody called me at 9:49, too. Oh, where was I here? Small fields. Gotta get off the small field thing. Okay, WSR flies year-round because they have... Larry, call me back. He's but dialing me, I'm sure he is. Small field. We have a small field that we fly all summer long. We fly up to G Motors, and we get a ton of people coming out because there's no place else to fly because all the high-power fields are planted at that time of the year. And then in the wintertime, we get our high-power field, and we get a turnout like you wouldn't believe because we have the capability of doing that. And how many certifications occurred last weekend?
Four.
We did four level certifications last weekend. Five attempts, four certifications were granted. Okay, so the section is able to really take advantage of that. And so it's wonderful to see that kind of growth going on all the time in this area. So it's really been a hotbed for promoting the hobby. And that's great because it takes volunteers and leaders to generate that more rocketry situation. More outreach, more launches, more support for the NAR, including volunteering for the NAR. You know, there is absolutely no reason that if you have a little bit of time on your hands that you couldn't provide a little bit of service to the NAR National if you feel you're qualified to do some of those things. And Ted, what do you think about volunteers? He's got a big thumbs up. So, you know, if you want to volunteer to the NAR National, please get a hold of Ted or one of the board members or even me and say, hey, these are some of the things I'd like to do. We can always use people to help us design and create web pages or run contests or start a new section or even do mailings and those kind of things. We've got things like that that can be done at the NAR. Hosting a national event is another thing that can be done. This is my second national event now. I hosted NARM 49 many moons ago, and now I'm doing NARCON 2016. Now, I know I'm not the only one that's paying forward there. How many folks here have hosted a national event? Wow, look at that. Holy smokes. Thank you, folks, for volunteering that. Awesome. Now, where's John Hockheimer? John, stand up so people know who you are. That's John. You want to come and talk about national events?
I can talk from here.
Okay, you can talk from there.
Okay. So all of you that have hosted a national event, who's ready to do another one?
Harem 75.
I'm not crazy.
Harem 75.
Bob, raise your hand, Bob.
We are not.
I see some waving hands over here, too.
Okay, good. We always need good volunteers, and like the federal government, we're here to help you.
No, John, that is not a good model. You guys don't understand. When John says they're here to help, they really do. They have taken a few things away, some big work things away from us, and hopefully things like registration and stuff like that in the future too. But anyway, they've taken a lot of great things away, so it has made it so much easier to host a national event.
Exactly. So who here is on a national event and had to deal with hotels? But you know what? We took that away from you. And we have a hotel group now that works with us, and they get us venues like this, and we get all sorts of really good venues, and we get good deals, you guys get good deals. So we do that for you. And
it was really good for us because I think John had like three or four different bids on what we wanted, and John's got some negotiation tactics going on where he's negotiating things that years ago we never even would have thought of, let alone be able to get some great benefits for us as a group. Oh, by the way, speaking of benefits, are you guys really sad? I mean, I was going to first announce the place as the Ramada when we came in because of the damn construction. But the hotel begs your forgiveness. And how many people are actually staying in the hotel this weekend? Most of you? Very good. How would you guys like free breakfast tomorrow and Sunday morning? Okay. If you did not get your tickets, go to the desk and get them. The restaurant will be open for you. They have a buffet free on Saturday and Sunday for those folks that are staying here.
They have Randy's credit card on file, so he's covering your back.
Don't, and if that means I call you after this event saying I need a ride to NARAM or something like that because I can't afford the gas, it's true. Anyway, thanks, John. Hosting a national event can be rewarding. Do it if you have that opportunity and skills to do it. Now, the section, being in a section, I'm very pro-section. Being in a section, I want it to be more rocketry for us in the area. And we've got fantastic opportunities that we've been working on for a couple of years, and they're starting to get to the point where we're ready to, you know, pull the trigger and make it happen. But we have a huge demand to the north of us for rocket flying, and we, as a section, hardly have the capability to go more than an hour away from Dayton to help out as a volunteer group. So we are working with the Waco Airport north of Dayton, and they are looking at starting a new section there. And the fun thing is, it'll be mostly a kids section. So it'll be mostly younger people that are getting into it. And that's going to be a great opportunity. They have a flying field. They have a building to meet in. It's a great opportunity for them. We are also looking at an area closer to Cincinnati because there's a huge demand there. And so we're looking at the Lebanon Library, using that as a meeting location, and potentially finding a flying field for the Cincinnati folks again, because there's a lot of Rocketeers there, but it's been a long time since they've had an established field. So we as a section, as we have built our leaders and our capabilities, we're saying, how can we reach out and make this more for rocketry? And that's one way of doing it. So I encourage you folks, many of you are in sections, look and see, does it make sense to have another section out there nearby? You can always go and fly with them anytime you want. That's a great way to add additional camaraderie and attention to the sport as well. And it's great because if you can get them to go find another field, then that's more rocketry for everyone. So that's pretty important. Okay, I've been talking a little bit about WSR, and I need to introduce those folks because they've been pretty important to me. They're Right Stuff Rocketry. We have some business cards that the section, let's pass those out, guys. Who's got them?
Where's the box?
Here, oh, over here. Okay, these guys are coming around. They're handing out the new business cards that just came in. We had a really bad scenario go on. We used to be known as...
What was that name?
Can I say it in public?
I don't think you can say it in public.
Team Ohio Rocketry Club used to be our name, and our club name was too close to a business's name, and they sent us a cease and desist order to stop using it as our name. So we recreated ourselves into Right Stuff Rocketry. Right Stuff Rocketeers is our section name now, and we have a new logo and everything, and this is kind of our grand finale of, you know, rolling it out and saying, hey, this is who we are now, and we're really continuing to change rocketry and make it better in the area. Anyway, Lee Berry is our president. Lee, come on up, because Lee wants to talk.
Lee, what's
some of the most important things that are going on at Rocketry with WSR these days?
Well, the most thing that we're doing right now is, you know, I'm not a scientist. I'm not an astronaut. I'm not even an author of a book. But I'm not even a great speaker either. But it's great that Randy gives us the opportunity and lets us use his building every Tuesday night. Not just one Tuesday night of the week. Every Tuesday night.
How many Tuesdays you got in a week there?
We get together as a club, invite new members, invite people that we've met at Tech Fest, different other outings that we go to, families. And we really appreciate what Randy has done for us. And one of the things is when we get together, say for instance if we need that very important part, well, if you don't know Randy's part, well, he's owner of Simrock, and he has all these great machines that we can actually make the part. Well, he can make the part. Randy, we need a nose cone. Randy, we need a tube. And well, we have a great time every Tuesday night. We meet from like 6 to 8:30. And so when we all get together, though, it's like we help each other. And we share techniques, all kinds of building techniques, and some type of glue techniques, CA. CA?
CA, man, right there.
Okay. Epoxy.
Hey, oh, get him another can, an accelerator.
Yeah, accelerator.
What a night.
Oh yeah, somebody said we had a paint booth. Yeah, we've got a little small paint booth that we can, you know, paint some rockets. But I think the most thing is to get togetherness that we have together, those couple hours that we get together, and we've decided on doing a project, upscaling a humongous rocket, and so that's, we're getting together, we're designing, and so it's just a great time we get together, build and fly, every Tuesday, 6 to 8:30. Be there! Salute!
One thing, when you have a club, it's a rocketry club, we have the band, other parts like AC guys, helicopter guys.
We can fly helicopter.
Yeah, well, see, the helicopter club comes in sometimes too, so anyway. Anyway, I want to also thank some of the other officers if they could stand up. Jay Berry is our vice president. Phil Queen's the secretary. Carter DeWard is our treasurer. And those folks do a wonderful job taking care of the leadership portions of the club. Also, a big thing that's dear to my heart is the contest directors. We as a club do not have one person that is the contest director. I did the first one or two, and then after that we've forced volunteered other people. So I want to say a special thanks to Mike Rohde, if you'd stand up, Jay Berry, Dave Combs, Phil Queen. These guys are all new contest directors over the last 2 years, just because they're all willing to stand up and do it. And it's not all that bad, is it, guys? Outreach, you know, high power certifications, we talked about this last weekend's flight, tons of certifications going on. Outreach, this group does schools, churches, Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts, camps, Waco Air Museum, we do different things out there. We go down to Cincinnati, the observatory, we do a big demo there every year. And we are also big supporters of the National Museum of the United States Air Force. We help them with their build and fly that occurs every year, and they fly imagine this, 500 rockets being built and flown in a Saturday afternoon within 3 hours and 15 minutes, because that's how much time it takes us to build, help kids build 500 rockets and get them off the ground. So that's an amazing feat. Nice job, guys, for making that happen. Now, the last time we did 500 rockets out there, that's where the picture on the front of the brochure came from. Right. We had one crash out of 500 rockets, and you saw the picture on the front of the cover. We're still proud of it despite that. That is not my rocket. It had some girl's name on the side of it, so.
You have to help your
building.
My family, they are so special. Also, I want to say, if you have an area, one area that we found successful and that everyone needs to be promoting is the social media presence in your section. Make sure you're on Facebook, make sure you're doing Twitter, make sure you have a web page. All those things really matter, because that's how people today find out about you. So do the social media thing. Also, any marketing you can do. We passed out some business cards. We put those together. They cost us $40 or something like that for 1,000 of them. And they are a great resource. Every member should have some of those to carry along with them. So that's pretty important. Okay, I'm halfway done now. What time is it?
8:41.
Okay, more rocketry, anyone?
Rockets.
If you're low, the bar is open.
What's a free trip ticket?
What?
Did you say free bus tickets? Is that what you're saying? All right, the industry also supports us, and I think that's important to recognize as well. E-Rockets provides a lot of support to individuals and groups, and that's why we really started in this whole business. I mean, I just think it was the luckiest thing in the world that I got downsized out of working for Meijer the supermarket for 27 years, and I got downsized. And the day after that, I started E-Rockets because I had signed a clause saying I would not compete with them, and Meijer sells rockets, so I don't compete with them when I work for them. Of course, the day after, E-Rockets was founded. From there, it was kind of interesting. My family might agree here. E-Rockets started in a little tiny bathroom in our basement. We had an unfinished bathroom in this house, and we shoved it all in the basement. So I had boxes on top of the bathtub. I had there was no vanity and stuff in there, so I had these racks, and rockets were stacked in there. And that's how I started, got on the internet. Soon enough, the unfinished basement became a box storage space for tubes and things, right? Because I acquired this company called Totally Tubular. I don't know if anybody's heard of them. But Totally Tubular moved into my basement. And then I found myself getting a job in a place called Dayton, Ohio. And so we came down here, or I came down here. Yay! Okay, good. Yeah, salute to Dayton! Okay. So I came down to Dayton, Ohio, and the Rockets did not follow me because I had a full-time job at that point in time. I couldn't do both. So I cornered this guy. His name was Bill Garrisey. He doesn't show up at many things, but he had an empty basement in Plainwell, Michigan. So we loaded up the truck and we moved to Plainwell. Loaded his basement up with stuff. And over the year and a half or 2 years that he had it, we literally filled his basement. It just continued to blossom, thanks to everybody's generosity and need for rocketry stuff. Then I got downsized at Avery Dennison down here in Dayton. And wouldn't you know it, my wife and I, we had a great discussion about, you know, what would it take to do rocketry full time? And we had to double business in order to do it.
A
lobotomy? And so, and a lobotomy, yeah. So we made it happen. We found a cheap place to rent here in Dayton. We moved E-Rockets here, and we doubled business in 1 year's time to be able to allow me to do this full time. At that point in time, I acquired a company called A to Z Hobby and Toys. And that brought more inventory to the whole program, and it expanded my line into high-power and medium-power rockets as well. Then shortly after that, acquired Semrock. So Semrock's actually been on our hands now here in Dayton for 1 year. It was about a year ago now that the containers started showing up one at a time, packed full of, wow, rocket stuff.
Where are you gonna put it?
And yeah, we had a building that was so small that every square inch, and I do mean every square inch, was all the way to the ceiling. The entire building was filled. In fact, our racks are 24 inches wide, and the aisleways were 25 inches wide, so you could at least take the box off the shelf and pull it down to get it off the racks. It was so full that it was unbelievable. And then my landlord did me a favor and said, buddy, you're out of here. I got other plans for this space. And so he made us move right after we got Semrock moved in. Yeah. I mean, we got the equipment set up. We were start burning our first things, making our first nose cones. And all of a sudden, I'm out looking for a new place to move to because we need to be out of there. Well, he said the next 30 days, but it took us 90 days to find the right place and get moved. So now we've moved to a home off of Thunderhawk, and you're all invited there. Sunday we're going to have an open house. We do have the world's largest selection of model rocket kits. And oh, by the way, we do have the world's largest selection of parts as well. We've got over 4,300 items in our inventory. So we've got quite a bit to choose from. We're going to have an open house on Sunday. Please come to the open house. Go to the museum, enjoy yourself, come to the open house before you head out of town. We'll be open until 7 o'clock or later if we need to be, but for you guys to come visit. Also, this is a great opportunity for me to talk about some of our other manufacturers and vendors, because it's really critical for us to have good suppliers out there. Rick Randall never made it tonight, right? Rick Randall's new way, he'll be here tomorrow. Aerotech, Gary Rosenfield never made it tonight either. Oh, there he is. Hey, Gary, I never got a chance to shake your hand. Hey, very good. Come up here a second. Come here. Some free advertising. Oh my God, that's Rick, right?
Rick, oh,
were your ears ringing? Come here, Rick. We got to talk about New Way. Gary, thank you for coming. Say a few words. What's going on?
New Way's a square rocket.
Here's a
I got some square carbon fiber tubes.
What's going on at Aerotech?
Well, you know, my son Charlie is appointed the general manager position, and I think a lot of you have noticed some changes going on, and we're trying to continue to roll out some new things from time to time. We just announced some new 38mm reloads that are USPS shippable, so that helps to reduce the cost for you. No hazmat fee for those. And we're looking at some other things like that. We just keep on the Facebook page if you're on that, or our website, and you'll see from time to time we'll be bringing out some new stuff this year. Hopefully some of it you like.
So is that what you could tell us at NARCON?
Well,
no, we want to know. You sent the note up. Don't
I have me. I have a box of goodies, you know, as usual. So
really?
You're not having a manufacturer's form.
No, not unless you want to talk at 10:30 tomorrow night.
Well, maybe.
Okay, you going to announce it at 10:30?
I can show some stuff at 10:30.
Okay, there is a spot for you to go, and we didn't know if anybody was going to be on the schedule or not, but we say Mike and his expertise as the Jedi wizard that he is put down vendor presentations in the Lindbergh room at 10:30 tomorrow night. That's your time. Alright? He's got something secret he's going to tell us. So, show up. Alright. Rick Randall is our guy from New Way. And I want to say thank you for coming and supporting us. Thank you very much. I know it was a long drive in and everything. You probably worked all day today too, right?
I did.
All right. Well, step up here and tell us what's new with New Way, because this is your commercial.
Hello, everyone.
Hello.
For me, all things are square, so the rocket, the square thing continues slowly. I am the sole one person that runs every single thing and designs everything and makes everything for the kids, so it's kind of slow going, but I do have two new kits that I'm releasing at NARCON tomorrow, so stop by and see those, and I also have a prototype for another new kit that's going to come out later this summer, which you're welcome to look and check. And I've got, you know, like a dozen other ones that I hope I can get to someday. So, square rockets, you know, they're a little different, but they still fly the same. And we've had, you know, I started in 2009, you know, it was kind of let's see what happens. And so now it's already 7 years and still putting along. So it's pretty exciting as far as I'm concerned. So thank you.
Come on, stand up and at least wave to everybody. Tim takes care of Apogee. They're a great company, and they really support our events, so that's good to have him here. North Coast Rocketry, where's Matt? Oh, there you are, Matt. Sorry. The glare was keeping me. Now, I sell his product. It's okay.
So the only thing I have is to stop by the table tomorrow. I have a brand new 2016 North Coast Rocketry catalog.
Yeah, it's kick-ass, too, so...
Come by and pick one up.
I want to know how much the new glider is going to retail.
$49.99.
Oh, my gosh. Does that include the no gears and stuff, so you just buy that? Okay. Get his catalog, you'll know what I'm talking about. Okay, who am I missing? Jack, you want to say anything? Our big publisher at ARA Press?
If I promised any of you that I'd be publishing your book, I'm sorry I'm late. This nasty real world working stuff has been getting in the way, but we are pushing back the frontiers of medicine, so that's another story. I have recently restarted work on the dinosaur book. It's not just the X-24, it's the X-24 was the development program.
There's a little bit of in the museum.
Yeah. What did I say, X-24?
Yeah.
X-20, yes.
It's a lifting body.
Yeah, X-24, sorry. I haven't slept for like 40 hours.
That's right, okay, Jack left last night. He got picked up this morning, and you haven't let him sleep at all, right?
No, he's been banging.
We were working hard on my presentation.
That's right. Anyway, also, of minor interest, I've got to... Lost in Space updates, the two paperback books. I did miss the 50th anniversary last year, but hopefully real soon. I had a question. and finally, a new book that nobody knows about yet, except people in our club. One of our club members, you may know him from NARM, Jim Basham, who got into competition in a big way and very first NARM set a national record. Anyway. He's doing a book, or has done a book, if I can get it together. It's along the lines of Mario Perdue's Seize the Sky. It's called Everything I Know About Rocketry I Learned from the Red Max. And what he's done is taken the basic Red Max platform, and he's upscaled it so you can do L1 certs on it. He's downscaled it to Micromax. He's made gliders out of it, he's made helicopters out of it, he's made multi-stage out of it, he's made clusters out of it, he's made cluster multi-stages out of it. And of course, there's always the classic kit scale competition. So, that one is completely in the can as far as getting all the materials to me. I just have to find the time to put it together and get it to the printer. So, just keep an eye out, and I'm sure it'll be in Sport Rocketry, or we'll look on one of the forums and you'll see it.
All right, awesome. Thanks, Jack. And you know, Jack's books have been so successful. I know NARCS is getting close to being out of Peter Always' book. Where's Peter? Is he here tonight?
Yeah. He'll be here tomorrow.
He'll be here tomorrow. Okay. Peter Always' book is getting close to being done. And Matt Johnson has a book out. Stand up, Matt, so people know who you are.
The author.
And he's the author of the N1 book that Jack has put out. So that's been a pretty exciting book. And that's getting pretty close to a second printing, or no?
Drinks,
he was drunk? I believe it.
I believe I said it.
Yeah. All right. Merlin Missiles, do you want to say anything? Come on up. Merlin Missiles is Lee Berry.
I happen to help our club as far as on our field. I supply rocket items to, you know, when you forget that last item, I'll go over and check with Lee. Lee's got it. And I'm a Narotech dealer. Thanks, Gary. And last month, we got to use an H550 Super Blue Thunder. And if you haven't used one of those, you better get one. That thing took off the pad like you wouldn't believe. And it was cool. It was an H550 Super Blue Thunder. But we get pretty good response out of our Rocketeers out in the field, and we appreciate that, all the Rocketeers do for me and Merlin Missiles.
Awesome. Thank you. All right. And then last but not least, it seems that John Bourne never gets to these things. Joe's pointing. What are you pointing at, Joe?
Rocket shot glass.
Rocket shot glass. It's a new item available from Joe for, you know, it's Joe's rocket shot glass. Are you selling these tomorrow?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, I'll be taking orders for them. They're 3D printed.
They're 3D printed.
And I'll give them to you on Sunday.
Yep. He's been selling lots of them. You can tell by the number of people that lift their glass every time I say rocket.
Rocket.
All right. John Bourne is the chief developer. He's the R&D guy, he calls himself, at Estes. And, you know, Estes is always pretty important to us as an organization. So I asked John, since he couldn't make it, to get us up to date on where things are. So here's his long, lengthy letter. Sorry again, I'm not able to attend this great event. They had me chained to my desk in order to get all the projects completed. Yeah, right. Hopefully a few of you have purchased and built one of the new scale kits that have recently been released. Who has built one of the new Estes scale kits? A couple? Little Joes? Come on. Who's built a Little Joe already or has got, well, at least bought one? Okay, I saw more hands go up now. What about the Mercury Redstone? It's been the main catalyst for Estes doing more scale kits since it's been selling above our expectations. And if you go to eRockets, you'll see the new packaging that's come out. All the scale kits now come in really nice black packages, just like the Little Joe 2 does. So take a look at that while you're over there. There are many more scale projects to do on the to-do list, with prototypes being made and test flown since we've been unable to get permission from manufacturers who are still in business or still producing them. In updating versions, we are unable to proceed with several kits. That's too bad. Why does he tell us these things? That, hey, there's a lot of scale models he's got designed, but he can't release them because somebody owns a license. Anyway, so even though range of scale offerings has narrowed somewhat, there are two more scale kits that should hopefully be released by the end of this year. That's exciting news. Similar to the re-release of the Saturn V. So we're not just talking the Saturn V that's coming up in September. We're also talking about two more kits. Like the just released Little Joe kit, I have also test flown another scale favorite that, to my knowledge, Estes has never produced before. It's a bit smaller in size and won't have as much detail on it, but it's a unique build-up balsa and index type paper fins should add a little extra building challenge to that scale modeler. In addition to true scale kits, Estes will be releasing its second sort of scale-like model. I love this part. It's kind of scale-like-ish. It's the Estes Shuttle, and if you've gotten one of the new catalogs, it's actually in the catalog. It's the first part being the Estes SLV that came out a few months ago. The satellite launch vehicle will be designed to use up a whole lot of excess balsa and two parts where the shuttle contains a few excess tubes. My prototype of the Estes shuttle actually flew at NARM 56 in Pueblo on Sunday. It hit a thermal and almost made it to the canyon, staying up for, I bet, 2 minutes. So let me see, if he made the canyon from the sport range, it would have strewn, he didn't trim that thing, did he? Instead of going around, it probably went straight to the canyon. Maybe one day I'll get to do full stack of the NASA shuttle powered by D&E motors. In addition to scale, we hopefully see the re-release a couple of Estes sci-fi models that haven't been around for 20 plus years. Wonder what that could be. All I can say about these two models is they don't use standard type nose cones, but instead have a cone specifically designed for their use. There are other models in the pipeline as well. And one uses a scale missile nose cone, so scratch builders out there can produce an Estes favorite if they wish. So he's selling us on a nose cone. He's going to sell us a kit so we can buy a nose cone. Ooh, he knows us, doesn't he? For the past 5.5 years, Estes has allowed me to design just about anything I could think of, and hopefully this will continue going forward. So what can you expect from Estes in the future? Expect the unexpected. Who would have ever thought an updated version of the old 1/45th scale Centauri Little Joe 2 would have made it into our lineup this year? And yet it's on the front cover of the catalog, too. The one thing I can say with confidence is that he should not... Oh, God. You know, every year, Rocketeers ask for one certain thing.
Send a rocket.
B-14.
No.
B-14s.
Every Rocketeer doesn't ask for a Cinerama.
B-14s.
B-14s.
What? B-14s.
One thing I can say with confidence is that you should not expect in your lifetime the re-release of the B-14 motor by Vestas that everyone keeps asking for. When you wish upon a star, makes no difference who you are, anything your heart desires might come to you.
Nice job, Dad.
All right, if you have your itinerary with a beautiful picture of the crashed rocket, inside is the itinerary of what is available to do this weekend. We have changed up Narcon dramatically. We want you to spend as much time as you can possibly do at the museum. There's so much to see. People say if you go for 2 days, you can almost start to see everything. And so there's great opportunities for you there. Spend the entire day at the museum. You know, go there. They open at 9 o'clock. It's free admission, free parking. The only thing I have to say is be careful. The security has been increased as a result of you guys going there. And they do have armed guards. The Air Force has troopers there in uniforms carrying their rifles. They are looking out for people. Pete's not here, so you warn him, Bob, tomorrow. Don't be jumping the barriers to measure crap, because it's not a lot. Okay? So warn Pete. I don't want him to get caught. They also have another dog on duty, and it's not Daisy, by the way. Okay? It's not Daisy. They have an extra dog on duty, and the dog reacts to black powder. So be careful. But I did find out the dog doesn't give a rip about AP. So you're good. You're good.
Just so you all know, do not try and take a pocket knife into the museum. You'll, best case, have to, you know, give them 50 cents. Or you're going to walk out to your car. And it's going to be cold tomorrow. None of you want to walk.
Oh, it's cold. It's above freezing. It's not that cold. Yeah, they've got metal detectors, and security is quite high. So just be aware of that. But they're there for our safety. So let them do their job. There are a number of tours, and Larry, we have maps available, if we could pass those out. Anybody that would like a map of the buildings, right?
Yeah.
Yep. And then Larry also has a very special item in his possession. It is a map of where every aircraft is in the museum. So if you want to find a certain aircraft, you may see Larry tonight, or you can purchase one of these for $5, right?
Donation.
They say a donation of $5. In other words, it's $5. Why don't they just say it's $5?
No, because it's 3 to 5.
Okay. Anyway, you can get those maps at two places, at the information booth up in the front lobby area, and then if you go behind the shop, to the left is a stand there, and you can buy those things there as well. Yeah, buy the Bob Hope exhibit. Now, on the other side of the shop is where they meet when they want to do tours. And we've got two touring opportunities tomorrow. We've got this really cool kid that really knows aircraft very well in the museum. He's a real smart ass too, so just ignore that part. But he'll take you on a tour, and they're meeting at 10 o'clock, and it's when you go through the store, and on the right-hand side, that's the meeting location. And Joe's going to be the tour guide, so stand up, Joe, so they know who you are.
No.
Joe's going to be one of the tour guides, so 10 a.m. meet there. Now, if you want one of the regular tour guides, the old guys, they are available at... It's in here. Somebody tell me. 1:30. They meet in the same place. They meet on the right-hand side behind the store, and you get a tour by an old guy that's there. So if he falls down or anything like that, you know, if you know the Heimlich or CPR, just be ready for that. Yes, sir.
Last time I was at the museum with the layout of this map, the X-planes. We're in a different hangar called a presidential hangar.
Correct.
Way to get a bus tour on.
They're closed.
And
it is
now. Those hangars are closed until June.
Yeah.
They are actually going to bring those back into the normal museum area, back on the outside of the fence.
Yeah.
That's not
that part is closed. They're also putting a lot of the new aircraft that are going into the new building there. So
on June the 8th.
The Valkyrie's already in the new building.
Yeah, June 8th is when the new hangar opens, so it'll be another great trip to the area. I have not been back to see the space shuttle exhibit. It is totally gone now, right? It's gone. It's moved into the new area. So what's in that place, Larry? Anything?
Empty
right now. Okay, so there's going to be a few empty spots. But anyway, use your guide here to get you through the day. There's a lot of good movies and stuff showing as well. There's also a map of this building, and we are basically in the two rooms next door is where the presentations are going to go. There's an amphitheater right out here by where the food was. We're going to be using this room for the vendors, so the vendors will be in these two rooms here tomorrow night. So the idea is go to the museum, enjoy yourself, go get yourself a nice dinner, or come back and take a shower, do whatever you want to do. The vendors will open at 4 o'clock if you do come back early. And then the sessions start at 6:30. The schedule, the revised schedule for the, 50th time? No, not, just kidding. The Jedi's been using his powers here, and nothing has changed since yesterday, right? Woo! That's very cool. So here is the schedule. It's an exciting schedule. It's got quite a few different things. We've got the first 7 centuries of rocketry with Pete Alway, which is going to be really exciting. The early days of model rocketry in the NAR with James Duffy. Jim, where are you? Hey, stand up so we can see you. In fact, come here.
Wow, sure.
Come here. We're going to give you a hard time. The History of Early Days of High-Power Rocketry by Chris Pearson. Chris, where are you?
Over here.
Come on up here. Get up here. Matt Steele's going to do FAI competition, etc. Thunder Down Under. Tom Ha. Where's Tom? Come here, Tom. Laminated Balsa Construction with Randy Gilbert. He's not here. Brian Gusak, you're doing a couple of different presentations. Where are you, Randy? There you are. Get up here. I'm sorry.
Excuse me.
Welcome to Ohio.
Been here all day.
The Rocketry Show. The Rocketry Show, communicating with social media. Cornelius, where are you? Come on up here. Let me see. Rob Young is doing German V2. Bernie, where are you? Bernie, come on up here, Bernie. Rick Wills is doing amateur liquid propulsion. Is Rick here? Pat McCarthy, come on up here. These guys volunteer their time, and do you know what we give them? We give them a freaking we give them a hand. We give them a freaking name badge and save them $5. Now, that's something interesting. What do we got here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. We got 8. 1, 2, 3, 9, 5, 6, 7. Okay.
And Peter.
How many? And Peter. But Peter's not here, so we're going to exclude him from this. How many of you guys are staying at the hotel?
So you don't know if you're going to get this prize or not. Not worried.
Random drawing.
What is it, a 5% discount of E-Rockets?
I can't afford that. You guys don't understand. I got a company to pay for still. I owe the McLawhorns money. Since Glida Estes, seriously, was going to be our speaker, could not make it, that means the Estes' room is up for grabs. So that means one of these people on the back of the business card has the word free. They're getting a free hotel room for the weekend. So who is it? Who got it?
Duffy.
Oh my God, Duffy got it. Okay. So because he volunteered, we're going to give you a free room, and we got to really say thank you, guys. You really mean a lot to us, and you guys were the first ones we thought of when it comes to giving a prize like this away. So anyway, thank you, guys, and please go to their sessions. It'll be a lot of fun, And like I say, they'll be in these areas here. You guys can sit down now. Thank you. Thanks again. And make sure to make it. Oh, it's only 9:11.
But who's counting?
My next page is blank, so I must have forgotten something.
Or you're done.
Oh. All right. Any questions before we adjourn here? Because we are done.
Yay!
No, we're not done. Okay, come on up, guys.
Our part of this is only an hour and a half. We're a little bit faster.
Who flew the G? That's before your time.
So on behalf of the National Events Committee, we do want to present you with this plaque for appreciation. Hopefully you'll put it in your office and you'll look every once in a while and think of all the time you spent working on this and helping us out.
And thank you as well for being the postponed Narcon. We had almost the last minute, we said we have the Seattle thing that is going to be at that time. As do some synergy if only you would agree to postpone it for a whole year. And he was really far along in the planning and everything else and had the website all up and he thought about it for about 2 seconds. Is that okay?
No problem.
Well, it's all for the better than our, you know. It's a pretty important organization. It's worth supporting.
So, and then Randy Gilbert, if you could. So Randy Gilbert was an NAR trustee for 4 years. 3 years, and that's right, 1, 2, 3 years. It just seems longer. So we have a National Association of Rocketry 2015 NAR President's Award for service to Randy Gilbert for that effort. He's also been and continues to be on the section activities committee, helping us make sure that all you guys get all the grants that you can ask for. And we still leave money on the table. $250 maximum. We have a $10,000 budget. You only used $7,000 of it last year. Do better. Thank you.
I gotta say, Randy, don't run away here. Randy, did you build that Mars lander?
Nobody ordered one from E-Rockets.
As a big group here. Tomorrow you're on your own to do things. And then Sunday we have the town hall meeting, and I believe it's right in this room. And then the museum is open again, and of course free admission, free parking, and E-Rockets will be open on Sunday. So there's a lot for you to do, and I guess the next time we'll see everybody is at the town hall meeting. Thanks for coming.